Good morning and warm welcome to all of you. Today we have the pleasure of having our one of the coordinators from our team with us, Dr. Prakash Kumar Rathod, with us. Sir is associate professor and head in charge, Department of Veterinary and Animal Husbandry Extension Education, Veterinary College, KVA FSU, Udhar, Karnataka. And the topic chosen for deliberation today by sir is Reorienting Priorities of Extension and Advisory Services in India and Post-COVID-19 Pandemic. Sir, you're audible and your presentation is visible also. Please start, sir.
Yeah, good morning, Majid ji, and good morning all the participants. Firstly, I would like to thank actually the organizers, the NIDCL team for considering this training program here. And I'll just go ahead with the presentation. Before I get into my actual presentation, I just would like to brief 1 or 2 minutes about myself. I'm basically from the veterinary background, working as a veterinary extension professional. And I have experience, even I had worked for 2 years in ICRISAT, an international organization, what most of you may be knowing, mostly the agriculture background people will be knowing. And I have worked there for 2 years during 2018 to 2020. And then actually I did my PhD from IVRI Izzatnagar, Uttar Pradesh, and a master's from Mumbai. Most of my presentation will be considering the issues related to livestock sector, but we also have some of the inputs taken from agriculture background because of some of my association with my IVRI as well as actually CRISAT. I will be happy actually if there are any questions to be undertaken or actually something to be discussed. I'll just go ahead with the presentation, and if there are anything we can discuss meanwhile. So this is actually my topic is reorienting priorities. As we all know that actually extension ultimately depends the productivity as well as quality improvement in agriculture sector or even in livestock sector or horticulture as well as fisheries sector. It all depends on the technology generation, technology transfer, and technology users as well as support mechanisms. See, our major focus is on technology transfer because we are from extension background. But the point here is, it is only the extension doesn't mean that only extension can do everything. But only thing we should understand that even the technology generation is important, technology users are important. So that is why we always say that actually we always need to be in touch with other people, other subjects. So that is the importance of being in touch with other disciplines. So then we also need to update the new technologies as well as scientific management practices on a regular basis as an extension professional so that we can communicate the same to our farmers. Then we have productivity can be substantially improved by effective targeted extension services. So it can be agriculture or it can be even a livestock sector. So we all know that actually there are a good number of agencies, multifarious agencies who are working with extension service delivery. But we have got a lot many issues, a lot many challenges, mostly in agriculture as well as animal husbandry sector. So both of them have their actually different issues and challenges. But just let us go to this particular slide wherein we are talking about different agencies dealing with extension and advisory services. See, we have agriculture department, we have animal husbandry department, we have fisheries department at central government. Then we have ICAR institutes, we have NDDB. We have KVKs, we have a state agriculture as well as veterinary universities. So we all know that actually through Government of India or through ICAR, we have got KVKs which are working very effectively at the field. And we all need to congratulate them for bringing in a lot many technologies to the field, that universities, the technologies which are being developed by the universities or developed by some of the departments are being actually spread over to different farmers through these KVKs. And that is one of the best model actually what we can see the India, like what we can see in India. Apart from this, we also have actually different cooperative federations. So it is actually a very cooperative federations. We have got maybe in different commodities. We have got like we have milk, we have poultry, we have sugarcane, we have actually other agriculture commodities. Then we have a lot many NGOs working, we have private sectors working. Yesterday, when I was talking about agri input dealers, wherein actually they play a very major role with agri input, like with regards to extension service delivery. Because I'm sure if you need any fertilizer or if you need any pesticide or if any farmer requires some medicine, he will ultimately go to agri input dealer or else a vet pharma company or some medical shop. So he doesn't directly go to an agriculture officer or he doesn't go to a veterinary officer. Even in my PhD studies, I have found that actually agri input dealers as well as wet pharma companies or even the pharma shops, actually they are the major, they play a major role in delivering different technologies or actually giving consultancies. See, they have a background of the technical background or not is secondary, but we should understand that farmers are mostly dependent on them also. And the major another stakeholder we have is the State Department of Agriculture. As we all know that agriculture or animal husbandry is a state subject. So it is ultimately the states which have to take this seriously so that the technologies are communicated to the field or to the farmers. Let us come to the important constraints or issues we are facing today in extension as well as advisory services. See, as we all know that lot many efforts are being made to make extension streamlined and actually make it very systematic, but still we find that extension still plays a role of being sporadic, very casual and even occasional as well as unorganized. And that is why we need to see that actually, because that may be because of several reasons. One is we have a lack of human resource, we have lack of budget, we have lack of infrastructure. See, we get budget somewhere in the month of December and January, and we are actually supposed to spend it by March, and we have a shortage of human resource. Where all these things are actually ultimately making extension still not so serious in the Indian context. And then we also have different failure of development programs, which are actually causing the lack of extension service. As I already mentioned, we have poor infrastructure and we need to take up good ICT tools so that we can reach the farmers. Then we have a wide range of options for sharing information. So we need to consider wide range of options, because once we were studying and we always say that face-to-face, we have a mechanism face-to-face. But nowadays, actually, the system is gone because we are not able to see our farmers, but we have to reach them in one or the other mode. So although we have wide range of options, we need to explore all of them so that we can reach the farmers. Then we have inadequate operating resources as well as financial sustainability. Then we have quality and reliability issues with the public system. See, even people do not much depend on public extension system, because there are a good number of studies on this. And then that is the biggest problem, because public sector is the main stakeholder to deliver these services, but still we most of the people do not depend on them. And then we have information flow we are talking about. It has to be a supply driven instead of being it should not be supply driven, because it has to go on demand basis as well. It should go on area specific options. I'll be just talking about some other slides, like we have a market led extension, what is going to be the new era, that what we should understand. And these are all different issues we are talking about, and they are going to be the biggest challenges for extension. And apart from this, we are also nowadays seeing the challenges of COVID-19, wherein actually we are not able to reach the farmers. Most of our staff are not able to reach the field. So even I'll take one or two examples from last 2 years, when actually even we know that COVID we are having from last March, but and another example is from last 2 or 3 months. Actually, even we have one project from ICR, but our field staff are not able to go to field from almost 2.5 to 3 months. This may be the case in most of the other situations. In the same way, we have master students, we have PhD students, wherein they are not able to reach the field. And that is going to be a biggest challenge, how to address all of these. So why are we talking about this topic is the context here. So need and importance of reorienting priorities. See, I was already talking about, we had a good number of speakers, actually, like the first speaker who spoke about global scenario, Dr. Rashid Suleiman. He was talking about what is happening across the globe and how should we actually improve ourselves. So we know that actually we need to address food needs, the livelihoods, we need to conserve the natural resources, and we need to look for the human and social capital, because this is what is going to be important. So at the cost of natural resources, we cannot actually grow more food, and at the cost of actually human resources, we cannot grow more food. And this is what is more important. And that is why we say it is the sustainability. And we need to address all these issues. And then we have the issue like nowadays, actually people, especially the extension professionals, should have better functionalities, or they should fulfill different job charts. See, once upon a time, actually face-to-face communication was considered effective. But nowadays, although face-to-face is effective, and we cannot really supplement this face-to-face advisory services, but today the time is demanding us to move towards different options like ICT, the digital media, and all these issues. And that is why we need to understand that our effort should be in all that direction. Sorry. Yeah. This is in continuation with that, we also need to understand what is the role of active support of the different departments and allied sectors, and our actual professionals need to improve ourselves with regards to different scenarios like data compilation, data driven personalized services, insurance, markets, input supplies. And this is all a vast activities or actually vast areas what we should understand. So I think if you can see the last second point, it is actually very essential with a vast network of various stakeholders involved in research, extension, education, marketing. So we have different areas here, and actually that is how we need to even address, and that too during the stage of COVID-19. And that is the important thing, and that's what we are trying to address a bit here. So this actually I'm going to put in some of the important areas, actually important slides around areas where we need to improve upon and where we consider that they are the priorities for us in case of during and post COVID-19. Firstly, coming with the reducing knowledge gap of farmers. See, we know that actually public sector extension service is supposed to be the good extension service, but most of the farmers, as well as actually many of them, are not considering this as a preferred option. That is just because of we are not able to reach them in time, and actually we have a lot of human resource constraints. So we can see that there is a ratio of 1:1162, means one extension person is addressing almost 1,200 farmers, which is very difficult. And if you say even 1,200 farmers, it is coming around 4 to 5 villages. And that is going to be a big task for the extension professional to do this. And interestingly, if you take the case of livestock sector, we see that only 8% of them are actually able to get the information related to animal husbandry. And while actually there are more than 40% of people who are trying to get information about agriculture sector. It means even the livestock sector or actually animal husbandry sector has to still grow a lot in this context, and so that they can reduce the knowledge gap of farmers. And ultimately, we are talking about different benefits of different extension modules like websites, applications, or websites or app, or apps is nothing but applications, and different tools wherein actually we have to come out of those conventional limitations and actually try to bring in these in our daily activities. Then how are we going to strengthen the extension as well as advisory services? We always say that actually there is no specific strategy. There is no individual strategy, because it has to always go with the situation, with the region, with the facilities we have got, with the infrastructure we have got. And we need to ultimately encourage participation of private organizations, NGOs, different corporate social responsibilities are also important. So I'll just take up the feedback mechanism. We always know that actually there is a poor linkage between research, extension, and farmers. And we see that universities are developing some technologies, and that is being pushed to agriculture extensionists, and many extension people are not able to make the technologies adopt in the field condition, because they know that what are the basic problems of farmers at field, and this is going to be a poor. This is going to be the biggest problem what we are facing. And many times we sit with many scientists, we talk about many other things, but we don't have time to discuss about our technology and convince the extension people how can we really address these issues and how can we bring back the feedback. So that is how actually this is the issue, and ultimately feedback from farmers is very essential so that it can be really tested again and modified as per requirement and given back to the farmers. This we need to address very seriously. And that's what actually I was talking about. When you talk about a feedback mechanism, it is the next step comes is about the improving research extension linkages. See, today, although we are not in a position to address most of these issues directly, but we always have a good communication with our researchers. We can make up some good relations, maybe have small meetings, have small deliberations, so that we can try to address these issues. This is going to be a biggest issue. Now, nowadays, actually, previously, the research people or actually the scientists used to tell extension people, go to field, go to villages and try to address the issues. But today, even the scientists should help the extension people to address the issue of COVID-19. So the scientists should be in a position to tell the extension professionals, how can we disseminate this in the field, even during the COVID-19 scenarios. So that is how actually we should have good deliberations and bring it to the limelight. Then we need to improve the relevance, effectiveness, and efficiencies. See, always actually we talk about the issues that extension people are not working well, and many times we also say that farmers are not taking the technologies. But on the other side, we also need to understand that there are lacunes with many of the technologies which are being developed, because we know that actually many of the technologies, although which are at the field conditions, which are being developed at the universities, are not able to reach the field because of one or the other limitations. And this issue also has to be addressed. When somebody says that this technology has a lacune, the researchers should be in a position to accept it and try to work on it again, and then bring it, bring the modified version over there. So this is the important thing. And the last point what we have is the participatory technology development. So we have a good speaker from NARM Hyderabad who will be talking about participatory technology development and in the in our training program. And that's what, and this is going to be another important thing for all of us. See, I'll just take one or two examples, even from my PhD work. I'll just give the example of artificial insemination. See, when we started working on, this is a very good technology, what all of us know, even agriculture people also know about artificial insemination. Despite having all these efforts, actually we have spent a lot of money, budget on this, but still the adoption of this technology is hardly 10 to 12% in India. So this is, we do not know actually what exactly is the reason, and people are actually not able to even find it out. And then whenever we say that actually artificial insemination has its own lacunes, there are many times the scientists actually are not in a position to accept it. So we need to understand actually whatever we bring is not our opinion, because it is actually the opinion of the farmers. And because I will tell my own examples, because when I did my PhD from IVRI and I was actually collecting good data from Haryana and Punjab, the farmers of Haryana and Punjab are actually very good, and they have a very good knowledge, actually I can say as good as scientists. And they had some issues with artificial insemination, and that is how we need to, like, for example, what they say is, what the farmers say basically is, we get actually more male cows out of artificial insemination. So because this point, actually when we bring it to scientists, actually the scientists also should be in a position to work on it. And there are some scientists actually who accept it, there are some scientists who again say that it is not possible. See, end of the day, we do not have a long-term study on this, which really finds out that whether it is correct or not. Because the farmers showed the data of 9 to 10 years, and they say that 90% of them born are actually the male cows. It is a debatable topic, but issue is, we need to find a good solution at the scientist as well as the extension level. In the same way, we have issues with vaccination. So these are actually some examples from livestock field, but there might be a good number of examples from even agriculture sector, and that is what is important. See, then we will come back to the capacity building in extension and advisory services. So we know that actually capacity building is very much essential for all the farmers as well as actually all our stakeholders. See, many times nowadays we are seeing there are actually a good number of students coming out with 10th background, with 12th background, and they want to have some basic knowledge about it. So the government is coming up with some diploma courses wherein actually they are able to guide the students for 6 months, 1 year or something like that. In the same way, actually there are paraprofessionals. Many times actually we consider the paraprofessionals as a competitors to us, but we should even try to restrict our syllabus actually. What should be taught to these paraprofessionals? What role should be given to them? And how are they going to really be a challenge for us, or how are they going to really address our issues is actually what is important. And in the field, actually many times they really give good services to the farmers, and actually we should also acknowledge their services. So then we have actually training for officers, training for actually professionals. Then the most important thing we need to talk about is the entrepreneurship. Nowadays actually the government is also trying to focus more on entrepreneurship. We have actually lot many agriculture as well as allied sectors, entrepreneurial activities, and this entrepreneurship also should be focused on market based, as well as it should cover some financial support related activities, or actually the knowledge for the farmers. If we do not give them the right knowledge about financial support, or how can we get the funds, it's very difficult for the farmers to really go ahead actually and be a part of entrepreneurship. Then this is actually about the farmers training, what I was talking about. This is, we need to think of a participatory mode of actually working with the farmers. That's what we say, it's a farmer-led approach. And then role of specialists, because we know that whenever you say that if I am organizing a training program to the farmers, if I am organizing a demonstration to the farmers, it is not only extension people have to do it. Many times if you feel that actually extension people are still not convinced with the technology, and if there are really technical issues again, and some more technical knowledge is required for that particular technology, we we can bring in those really the specialists, and that is important. Even because the extension people, if they are not in a position to explain it, I think the researcher who has really developed this technology can come to the field and actually explain in a simple way, so that or else explain these complete technology to the extension people separately and then actually bring it to the farmer. See, this is how actually we need to say. Apart from this, I just would like to take another example from the government of Punjab, wherein actually the Department of Animal Husbandry is having a place for an actually agronomist who is looking after the fodder production. So although this issue is, this point is there in majority of the governments in animal husbandry or agriculture sector, there is always a person from either in animal husbandry or actually there is a person from agriculture. Because I saw this model is very successful in case of Punjab, because I have seen good literatures as well as I have discussed with some of the veterinary officers who are there. And this is having an agronomist in the animal husbandry department is an advantage, so that he is taking care of fodder related aspects, fodder seeds, vegetable, fruit waste. In the same way, we can think of having a specialist in any of the, in majority of the programs, so that the program can be more successful. And then we have actually the capacity building activities merging with the awareness activities. See, many times we see different programs coming up. We see actually a lot many vaccinations done, a lot many health camps being done. We are trying to create awareness to them, and along with awareness, you can, we can even try to distribute some literatures. We can bring in some education campaign so that most of the farmers are also aware about these activities. This is another point, what is important, the gender, because whenever we are talking about any of the extension activities or any agriculture or animal husbandry activities, we should understand that there is a strong informal association between the woman with agriculture or with livestock. Because many times the government programs very rarely actually consider this point, and actually most of the programs are being framed for the men farmers. And but we should understand that actually the face of Indian agriculture is that of a woman. So that is what is being considered, and that is why actually we need to see that most of the women are also being addressed, and having good women extension workers is also very important, because a male worker cannot go and contact all each and every woman, but actually a woman extension worker can really address these issues. I just, you can see one image actually wherein one of the women actually in Orissa is actually acting as a good extension worker or cycle. So she goes to each and every home and actually explains about different aspects, talking even from the home science background, even from the health of the mother, health of the kids, the child, the agriculture practices, the role of woman, the vegetable, and then many issues which are being addressed by these extension workers. And we should see that gender is also given a very good importance, and especially, I mean, the women are given the due recognition as well as they are considered. Because whenever you organize any training program, among 30, you don't find any single woman. Among 50, you don't find a single woman. And normally the men are attending the trainings, and many times they do not go and communicate whatever they have learned in the training program. So this is going to be the biggest problem or the challenge. So this issue also has to be addressed, taking it on priority basis. Nowadays, because we see actually majority of them mobiles are with the males again. And again, if you send some SMS, if you send some message, this is not going to reach the woman. So we need to find some strategies actually, because I know KVKs are sending messages, the departments are sending messages, the universities are sending messages. Okay, we are not sure actually whether it is reaching the women or not. So that is the issue what we have to address. Then in the same way, actually there are, when I'm talking about women, it is actually the continuation with that. We have women dairy cooperatives, we have women SSGs, which are actually very much successful across India as well as across the globe, because the dairy cooperative concept is actually a very good concept even in the international forum. And we need to see actually how, because we see lot many number of women dairy cooperatives, and they should have good support from women extension workers. So that is what is going to be big challenge for even all of us. And even the SSGs actually have also excelled across in agriculture as well as allied sectors. Coming on to the next point, that is developing infrastructure. See, what we all know that actually extension activities are not possible sitting at home, because sitting at office, many times we have to come to the field. And but that is why actually we need some basic facilities, like we have actually a vehicle facility, we have actually, and if you're organizing some training program, you should have some literature to be done, you should have audiovisual aids, we should have actually different mobile extension vehicles, what I already mentioned. And now we should see during the COVID-19 pandemic whether our officers are actually comfortable in using online tools and online media, because that's what I was telling even yesterday. Nowadays, we have got a lot many tools as well as a lot many medias, how we can address these issues. and our extension professionals should be in a position to improve their skills or try to have certain skills and improve their competencies so that they can address the issues during COVID-19 pandemic. Then we have actually the role of public-private partnership. Today, actually, all these activities we are talking about is actually about the, because we say that it is actually going to be the thought pattern and method of choice, because public system has their own lacunes, private sector also has their own lacunes. And end of the day, we have good collaboration between public and private sector. I think actually we can do really good wonders. And even the ICR draft policy actually has also considered that actually this public-private partnership is going to be an appropriate one. I'll just take one example from actually Tanuas, wherein actually the Tanuas KVK Namakkal, we will have actually one lecture from Dr. Akhila Natarajan. And they have made an attempt of taking up actually linking with the farmers, where actually they give some good fodder seeds to the farmers, and fodder seeds actually grow these fodder in that field, and they come back with the fodder seeds. These fodder seeds are again packed up and they are being sold. And that is actually, I think this mechanism has taken up actually considered almost more than 160 farmers, and they are actually linking with this. This is a newspaper coverage what we got. And this actually started somewhere in the year 2012-13, and it is actually working very well. Even somebody is interested, and I think it is a good model for all the KVK personnel. If you can refer the KVK Namakkal website, you can also go through different literatures developed by them about this topic. And then actually one of the attempt what our university made was to, because we came up with an linkage with an NGO in Bidar, Karnataka, and that is actually under the Karnataka Livelihood Mission project. We could train more than 1,000 farmers over a period of 2 months, because we had different batches coming to the universities, and actually they were actually trained on technical aspects like dairy, agriculture, and we had all the technical support given to them. So this is how actually we could address that issue of actually the public-private partnerships. And then that is important. And coming to the latest versions, nowadays we are seeing actually during the COVID-19 pandemic, we have seen a lot of public-private partnerships coming up. We have seen actually a lot many linkages coming up. We have good literature which says that actually there are more than 450 agri-tech startups in India, and that they are mostly doing it through digital partnerships. And this is how actually we have seen how people are able to market, how people are able to sell their commodities. And one of the interesting collaboration was actually a multinational company, Bayer, and a Pune-based e-commerce firm, AgroStar. And what they did is during this time of COVID-19, actually they could send the seeds to the farmers, pesticides to the farmers. In the same way, a lot of good examples have come up in actually agriculture sector, animal husbandry sector, the horticulture sector. And we can see good number of literatures which have come up. It's like one of the forum, what even Dr. Sashidhar was mentioning yesterday, is about agriculture extension in South Asia. So actually, Dr. Rashid Suleiman is handling this forum. So we have agriculture extension in South Asia. If you just refer that website, you get lot many good practices done, lot many good blogs on different policy topics, lot many literatures being developed. So that is how actually we can see how a public-private partnership can be helpful for all of us. Then we need to have different experiences of institutional convergence. We should have a synergetic strengths, and we should see how which institute is good in what and how can we really collaborate. See, one such example what we are trying to collaborate is the training program of COPSU Bidar and NADCL. So COPSU Bidar, being a public organization, has its own limitations, and NADCL also has its own limitations. So this is one best example of having a public-private partnership. See, working with ICRISAT, actually I had some opportunities of, we had some opportunity of collaborating with different organizations. ICRISAT had collaborations with state agriculture universities, the RICE, International Rice Research Institute, the International Livestock Research Institute, Water Management Institute, and Vegetable Institute. So there are actually different partnerships we had, and we actually had opportunity of working with them. And then coming on to the next point, we need to look at the extension competency development. We have actually one or two, again, presentations coming up in detail on these topics, because again, we need to address that how are our extensionists going to change their competencies, improve their competencies. Because nowadays we need to see that actually people are talking about FPOs, people are talking about digital media, people are talking about value addition, people are talking about agribusiness. How are we going to address all these issues is an important issue for discussion. And that is why we need to see that our extension professionals can improve knowledge and skills, in social media, in using it, and they should be in a position to understand what tool and how to use them. Because I was talking even yesterday, like we have Google Meet, we have Zoom, we have WebEx, we have actually different platforms wherein actually many of them we are not even clear with how to use them. But the time has come that we need to understand them and how to really reach the farmers by improving our competencies is important. See, we have Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, YouTube, and so many other Telegram, and many things have come up, and we should be in a position to understand them and actually try to use them. In continuation with that, we need to understand that actually we need to have a better tools developed for the next generation, and this is how actually we can really try to improve ourselves. And we have actually one or two lectures again coming on this topic, basically about improving the skills, basically improving the competencies. I think you can have a better clarity over there. Then this is actually an important topic for most of them, and I'm not going to deal too much on this because we have got different speakers coming again. Yesterday we had a talk on online education, and then we have actually people one presentation from about developing mobile apps and how to use them, and then we also have another presentation coming about digital media in detail by Dr. Sarvanan Raj, and we also had some discussion yesterday about the ICT. There are many issues with ICTs. We understand there are a lot many challenges with the farmers. How do we reach the farmers? See, the point of interest here is, see, we are not able to reach the farmers even through face-to-face media. But somewhere we can see that farmers are able to purchase mobiles. Farmers are able to get most of the things done. See, if they have any issue, if they want to ask a price, that are actually the market price of Jawar today, they contact some person, and they say actually that I'm able to contact person, or they get the information over phone call. In the same way, actually, many things actually they can get over phone call, and that is why actually mobiles are going to be the new trend actually today, so that we can really address the issues. There are a good number of questions actually rising about the ICT, how can we reach, but actually one or the other way, we should understand that this is going to be cost effective method of reaching the farmers, and of saving time, and of reaching more number of farmers in less time with a less cost. And that is the important thing. And we have different ICT tools. Anyways, actually, Evan, I have mentioned about all these things yesterday. We have rural telecenters, mobile telephony, information kiosks, social media, TV and radio. So there is another lecture coming up from Dr. Kashyap from Pantanagar about the community radio. And we have mobile applications, we have different websites. So they are all actually addressing most of the issues of farmers, and actually we are able to contact them. And I'm sure most of the universities, most of the KVKs are also doing all these things, and they are trying to address the issues of farmers through the SMS or through the messages, through video, through radio. They're all actually the different objectives or actually different initiatives what we have got.
I think sir got disconnected. Let me try his number. Participants are requested to have patience. Our resource person got disconnected. It will take him 1 minute to join back. Just a second. Yeah, sir is here with us. Hello. You are on mute, I guess, sir. Can you unmute?
Sir, can you unmute yourself? I think you are mute.
It's fine now. It's fine now.
Yeah, now the voice is coming, sir.
Yeah, okay. My screen is... Can you see the screen?
Yeah, visible.
Yeah, so I think actually there is some issue with the ICT, with the ICT training also. Because whenever we are talking about ICT, I think the slide is getting disconnected. So I don't actually know how many slides I have missed or you people have missed. So did we discuss this? Hello.
No, sir. No,
no sir. We are not.
Not.
Sir.
Yes.
Yes.
No. Have you done this ICT? Is it okay?
Yes.
Yes. I think one slide after this.
This has been done.
One slide after done. This.
You are somewhere at Ecosat Experiences.
Somewhere at Ecosat Experiences.
Yeah.
Have you done this?
Yeah, from here.
Done.
From.
Yeah, okay. Sorry for that. Yes, actually, as all of you, most of them actually considering like universities as well as KVKs are working on this concept of mobile telephony, sending audio messages, video messages, recordings, and small videos. And we have actually all the web portals and all these. And this is actually a newer version we have nowadays. We have good initiatives. We have actually lot many applications being developed, the mobile applications, different websites being developed. Even ICR is greatly supporting this concept of ICT and development of different websites. You can see actually one lady who is using actually a kiosk. And nowadays these kiosks have a facility of audio and video. So wherein if you cannot read even, but you can listen to the kiosks. So that is important thing, and there are actually the advancements what we have got in the technologies. See, next I am talking about the internet users, because 2015 to 2022, we can see there is an increase in the number of internet users, and that is how actually we can really address the issues through internet media. And then see the different groups, actually the Facebook farmers, Facebook is being
used. Receipt print outed. Sister, on panna theriyala. And the sister, on panni eduthra.
Yeah, I request. I request the participants to please mute yourself. Yeah, this is about the Facebook for farmers. In the same way, actually, we have different groups for the officers, different many of the farmers are discussing about the marketing issues, talking about marketing of different commodities. Many of the veterinary doctors are sharing their field experiences, asking different doubts. These are actually different things what is being done, and that is actually an important strategy to be considered. In the same way, actually, this image I have taken from one of my senior Dr. Devesh Thakur's study, actually how he has created WhatsApp group for the farmers. We had actually experts on one side and farmers are one side, and actually they used to have different discussions. You can see experts from vegetables, veterinary, horticulture, plant pathology, floriculture, entomology, and on the one side we also see different farmers asking different questions, and they are being addressed. And that is the important thing what is required. And we have good number of YouTube videos, maybe that is developed by universities or different KVKs. They are the good practices what is being done, maybe it is even the farmer's experience what is being done, and they are all we can keep sharing them to the farmers. And coming on to the next important aspect is about the market driven approach. See, we all know that actually whatever we do, we need to focus on market, because most of the previous concepts, like I say, production led extension. So we always thought of giving good seeds to the farmers, good fertilizers to the farmers, good pesticides to the farmers, and we never addressed the issues of marketing to the farmers. And that is what is important is about talking about the market also. That is why actually market-led extension is another important priority area what we should talk about. So, and then actually we can really bring in farmers into this. So just one or two images where actually even our university could address the issue of value addition actually, and make the farmers to prepare some products actually at their house and then actually sell it off or actually give it to some hotels nearby. And market, we should understand that nowadays actually the biggest advantage we have is about the eNAM platform. And I'm sure actually most of you will be aware about this platform, and we have registered more than 166,000 farmers, and some of them actually are still left out. We are actually in the way in the process of bringing them into the limelight, bringing them into this platform, and more than 785 markets are connected, and we have almost good number of commodities connected. And this is all actually is going to be about market and extension. In the same way, there are good number of people who have tried to sell their commodities through Facebook, to WhatsApp. See, big cities actually like Mumbai, Pune, actually they have created a small group, and actually in the apartments actually they could sell different vegetables, different commodities. There are good number of examples like this. But end of the day, you should see that market-led extension is an important aspect, and this is actually a government initiative about the eNAM. Actually, how do we try to sell our commodities? And it is actually, it has become a very easy concept for most of the farmers nowadays. And we need to address these issues, and we need to even bring in more number of farmers to this particular platform. This is in continuation with that. And then this is actually an important slide where I was talking about how to bring, how to shift from a production-led extension to market-led extension. Because initially we always saw that actually we spoke about seeds to seed. You see, if I'm giving 10 kg of seed to a farmer, how much is his yield? But in my next focus, actually, if you talk about market-led extension, if I say 10 kg seed, if I give, how much is the farmer earning? So we say rupee to rupee concept. But in the previous concept, we spoke about seed to seed concept. And that is what is important. Then our major focus was on talking about production related aspects, but now we have to talk about even the market aspect, considering this or any farming as an enterprise. And that is the important thing, how we need to address our farmers. This is about, again, in continuation with that, see, we need to see each and every step. Okay, where did I spend some money? Where did I invest? In the previous concept, we had only the research extension farmer linkage. But today we need to talk about research extension, farmer, and market linkage, because that is the important point for all of us today. And then in continuation with that, we see actually different marketing approaches being done through this concept of group association approaches. And we also have FPOs which are in limelight nowadays. We have actually a separate our exclusive session from one of the scientists from IRI, Pusa New Delhi, talking about FPO. It's how to farm, what are the limitations, how are they helping in marketing. But we should see that this is an important concept, that we have livestock interest groups, we have commodity interest groups, we have SHGs, we have JLGs. These are all actually working, and they are actually the successful models. Even the cooperative itself is another good model of model for all of us with regards to marketing. See, this is just in continuation with that. And I'm just saying actually how farmers are able to market their commodities. The FPOs actually should now become a part of Atma as well as KVK. So somehow in some places it has been done, somewhere formally, somewhere informally. But we should see that actually we are able to link FPOs with Atma and KVKs formally or converge with them so that most of the commodities of the farmers can be sold. And FPOs actually are going to be the biggest supporters for our market. Even the government has actually planned to develop, I think, even established more than 10,000 FPOs in India. So that's a different program what government has announced, and that is being worked out by different organizations. Even FPOs get a good remunerative prices, and we don't have to run too much behind middlemen or actually other people. So FPOs is going to be one of the good model for all of us. But I'm sure actually Dr. The next our resource person will be in a position to address most of these FPO related issues. Then this is another concept about farmer led extension approach. I was mentioning that my field staff, actually my project staff, could not go to a farmer or field actually from almost 2.5 to 3 months. The next option we have is actually to create some extension farmers. Like they act as extension agents. You call them actually maybe professors even. There's no, because they take all our role of extension, and you educate them nicely and you tell them actually how to go ahead. You send them some small videos and they can take the role of extension agents. That is what is to be done now. And how are we, like when we people are not able to go to their villages, actually we need to have an extension agent in their own village who can really address these issues. See, some of the models can be like, if I say the government identifies some people, some extension agent or former extension agent, give him some incentives in the first stage, maybe in the first year or second year, then immediately try to have it in on 50-50% share, and then bring it to the next, again, in the coming years, you just see that the extension person is able to get his own charges from the farmers. And we also see that there are many people to people ready to pay for these extension services. There are a good number of studies on this topic. So can we really explore this opportunity and try to have our own extension, our farmers as extension agents? So this is in continuation with that. That's what I was talking about, a concept called farmer professor. So there are many projects actually about this. We are also trying to see actually how the farmers can be brought into the mainstream and how they can be used as extension agents. And ultimately, I mentioned that these farmers can act as a good extension agent when their university extension person or a KVK extension person cannot visit their villages during the times of COVID-19 or any such disasters. Then we have a different roles of institutions. Actually, what is being done, I was already mentioning, actually KVK is working on this, ICT is working on this, and we need to explore different online channels, and we need to see how to address the issues of the farmers and bring in different marketing scenarios. And if we are not able to bring in with our human resources, can we bring in some internship students? Can we have UG and PG students as some internship students and actually have some extension models developed? We should see actually how we can really explore these opportunities with regards to markets, with regards to input delivery, with regards to social distance, immunity related protocols, and all these things. And I'm sure actually majority of the universities are already doing this. Majority of them have already started putting their materials in the websites for the farmers, for the students, and for the other public domain use. And this is actually an initiative that is being appreciated. And next important slide, what we need to talk is about the investments, because I really had some experience of working with my guide at IVRI, Dr. Mahesh Chander, and we could actually study that there is very less investments for extension. And that is, I can say actually in one of the studies, we could see hardly 1% of investment is being done for extension. But meanwhile, there are good number of studies which says that we should at least invest 10%. We should at least invest 10% to, hello, am I audible?
Yes,
Majid.
Yes, sir.
So there are actually good number of studies which say that we should invest at least 10% to the extension activities. Like if I have 100 rupees given to agriculture sector, 10% should be given to extension. And if 100 rupees are given to animal husbandry sector, 10 rupees should be given to extension, livestock extension. But this is not happening. And that is actually the biggest issue we have, because another point of discussion we have is the investment and returns. How much are we investing in extension and how much are we getting back in terms of benefits, in terms of the returns, in terms of the production, in terms of the market. So they are all different issues what we are facing. And that is why actually, and if you even talk about extension, I'm sure majority of the university faculty, majority of the officers they even take the things very lightly, because that has become a big issue, because we do not have the right data with us, and this is a time to explore all these things. And this is actually one study what we conducted for animal husbandry sector in the year 2012-13. Almost it was one year study. And interestingly, we studied all the union territories and states in India. And this is basically for animal husbandry sector, because since we are with that background, and we saw actually that nobody is giving the right data about the budget. We are not able to get the budget utilization in extension. So that is the biggest lacuna we have. I'm sure most of you also may be facing the similar problem. And if we can go through all the websites and contact different officers, and what we got is the data from only these 7 states. And this we could bring it, and we saw that actually Meghalaya is contributing good, giving good budget actually for extension activities. And you see actually other states wherein there is only almost 1 or less than 1 or even 1 or 2%. But our study says that actually we should give at least 10% to extension activities among the total budget. And that is an important thing we need to address. And next, the next point we have is, I think this is going to be like, we are left with hardly 4 or 5 slides now. So this, we are talking about strengthening government schemes and programs. So this is going to be another biggest issue, because we have got government programs. Even recently, government has announced a lot many good number of programs during COVID-19, like we are talking about micro food enterprises, we are talking about Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, we are talking about infrastructure projects up to 1 lakh crores. And how are we going to utilize this? Actually, how are we going to do this? Just we have got some of the experiences, like when we see actually that when the farmers are interested to have certain programs, or when it is not really useful for the field, but still actually there are many of the programs which are being utilized are being implemented. And many times the farmers expect that a few programs have to be implemented in certain way, and it is not being many times done. And the issue here is about the top to bottom approach. And most of our projects are coming from top to bottom, and a very, very less number of projects are actually considering this point of actually bottom to top approach. And this is how actually we need to address, and most of these schemes should really reach the people who are needy, who are really required. And that should be taken up on a serious basis, and it should be done in the well-structured way. And it is again continuation with that. We have got different programs. We have PDS, we have ICDS, we have MDM, we have actually the NAREGA program. We see actually a lot many good number of well-educated people who have come back to their native places due to COVID-19. They have left their cities and they have come back to the villages. And I think somewhere we need to even try to accommodate them, because NAREGA initially is actually a program for only some registered laborers. But we should also think of these type of farmers or these type of actual laborers who have come back from the major cities or bigger cities, and they are actually staying back at the villages. And apart from NAREGA, I think the government also should think of some household related job opportunities or employment opportunities which can really help them all and have a better livelihood. So this is the important slide, because we need to see that ultimately whatever we do, agriculture innovation system is an important concept. We have farmers or farmers organization in the center, and this is being addressed, and this is actually a linkage between all these different agencies. See, if you develop some commodities, we need to have a good market, we need to have a good logistic support, and this is again a good we need to get a good support from extension people, good support from researchers, support from policy. So innovation system is basically about talking about the technology generation, the technology transfer, the technology dissemination, and actual and reaching to the field. And we should understand that majority of our technologies or whatever the information or whatever we have should go or should follow this concept of innovation system. Nowadays, agriculture innovation system, and people are talking about livestock innovation system, people are talking about the dairy innovation system. And this is actually the need of the day, that we need to have linkages among all these different agencies or stakeholders, so that we can really improve ourselves. So if I bought actually about 100 liters of milk, and if I do not have a good road connectivity, I cannot send this milk to a city. I cannot send this or sell this to city. And if I really produce some value-added products like to ice cream, peda, something like that, if I do not have a connectivity, I cannot sell it. And we need an extension person, or we need a researcher who can explain how to produce some value-added products. and ultimately we have got a we need to have a good linkages for all these stakeholders so that we can really improve the scenario of the farmers. And coming to the conclusion, so we should we know that actually there is no single and specific strategy for improving the extension and advisory services. Thus, things should go as per requirement, as per the demand. Okay, it can be region based, it can be commodity based, it can be. So hello. Yeah. So yes, it can sir. Be even company. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Fine. 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 So we need to see that it is. We should have the. Strategies as per the market requirement, and we should see that actually we have a vast network of stakeholders, and we need to follow different approaches. Please mute your mics. The participants.
I am muted. Please continue.
Yeah. So we have actually the grassroots level functionaries actually, and we need to see that most of the things are taken up from the grassroots level so that actually they can reach the bottom to top approach, and actually the good programs are being implemented in the field level. And end of the day, we should see that ICT, the public private partnership, the human resource development and farmer led extensions actually are going to really help us, and they can be the good solutions for us in order to improve the productivity as well as in order to improve the sustainability as well as extension scenario. And this is actually from the from my side. And actually, if somebody is interested to go through the literature, actually this whole of my presentation is taken from this particular paper which we published in Indian Journal of Extension Education last year, because that was again during the COVID-19 pandemic only. So this actually is available in Google, this is available in the particular journal website, and this is also available in ResearchGate. Somebody is interested, because whole of my presentation is taken from this particular paper which we published last year. And thank you all the participants. This is actually a view of ICRISAT. So just an image. If there are any questions, comments or suggestions, it is open for discussion. This is IVRI where I did my PhD program. Thank you all the participants for your patience hearing. Thank you, Majid ji.
Thank you, sir. Now, if there are any questions or interaction or suggestion, please from the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prakash ji. I am Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Dubey from KBK Lucknow.
Thank you, sir.
Any study on sex semen in cow and buffalo, and what is the success rate?
Sir, since you are from Bundelkhand, actually I can say that 2 years we worked in Bundelkhand region of Uttar Pradesh.
Yeah.
And we had a tie-up with BISLD, I think you might be knowing.
Yeah, yeah.
During that period, actually we saw that almost 93% to 94% of, we have this 93% to 94% is the female calf rate. And that was actually a good success rate we found.
Doctor, Sahab, what is the conceive rate? In cow? Hello?
Hello, Dr. Prakash. Sir got disconnected, he's joining back, just a second.
Okay.
There might be network issues at certain places, so that happens. That is beyond our control, the net at resource persons level. Thank you. Sir is here again.
Yeah, Dubey ji.
Yes, Naksha, what is conceive rate in cow?
It is actually, in case of this one, it is around 45% to 50%.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in the natural service we have around 30% to 40%, but here it is comparatively better than the natural service. And we don't promise that it is actually somewhere around 80% 100%, but that's a study what we have done, because I was there in ICRISAT, and we implemented a program actually that is doubling farmers' income in Bundelkhand region of Uttar Pradesh. So you might have seen actually many of the other forums, and our team actually at CRISAT used to be there, and we have conducted different studies on this and different livestock related activities also. So we had a collaboration with BEF, we had collaboration with the CAFRI at Jhansi, we had collaboration with IGFRI at Jhansi, and a few other agencies.
I have a development at KVK, and five cows is there, and I my animal scientist tried three times, but we could not success.
Okay, so what was the success rate, sir?
No, failure, totally failure in three attempts.
Okay, so even there was actually a workshop in Pune, I think in the year 2019, I hope, and wherein actually the because this program was initially put in 8 states, it was initiated in 8 states of India, and even the principal secretaries, even the directors of those 8 states actually had come there. If you want, I can share the literature also, and they even expressed that actually it is having around 40 to 45% of conception rate, and they have got around 85 to 95% of female calf rate. Anyways, I can share more details
okay.
on that.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Ji. Dr. Goyal ji,
sir, there is few questions in the chat itself. One of them is like by Jayanta Datta. He or she says, "Nice presentation, sir. I have one observation that due to COVID-19 pandemic, farmers are facing a lot of psychological issues like anxiety, depression, etc. How can we think of reorienting the roles of EAS in this aspect?" Other points, this is first question. And the other question is, major focusing extension approach is agroclinic activities for imparting advisories or advisories for managing problem related to pests and diseases. Extension tools for holistic management or operating procedures for a particular cropping system in terms of economic gain are lacking. That might be the second, that this is by Jai Prakash, Jai Raj P K A U. Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes.
I think you got disconnected again. Just a second.
Okay.
Just he'll be joining back again, just a second.